The Weedsman Podcast, ChristopherMedia.net.
When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more. When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more. When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more.
Christopher Media, let's make some noise. From Asthma Corps Studios near Detroit, Michigan.
Oh, man.
It's the Weedsman Podcast.
I have no idea what's going on.
And now...
you have smoked yourself retarded.
Here are the Weedsmen.
You want to get high?
It's the Weedsman Podcast. It's the Halloween show. I'm Chris.
It's the Halloweedsman show?
Oh! Yeah,
it almost works. I'm Aaron.
Really? In 7 years, we haven't said Halloweedsman? Oh, now we have.
Yeah. I probably said that joke in like year two and then forgot it.
Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween. Happy Halloween to you. I'm just rolling up some analog weed here. Get another joint going so I have it ready for the show.
I have some analog weed too.
We're on that old school kick. Right. I was just telling you before we started recording that I was getting this stuff. The dispensary local to me has started selling these ounce bags of shake. And first it was 70. Now they've recently dropped the price down to $50 for an ounce of shake. That's hard to resist. And it's not like it's a bunch of sticks. Like I've got no seeds in here.
Yeah, this isn't shake like you used to get from like your dealer back in the day.
This isn't trimmings. Like, this isn't something that someone would give you a pile of to make brownies with or process in some way. This is legitimate, like, fell off the plant while they were processing it, you know, trimming it and handling it and all that. And sure, there's a couple leaves in here, but in general, like, all smoke's the same. You just get the tiny little sticks out that get in there and you're good.
Yeah. This is not your father's shake.
Well, it's because, you know, they're probably, I can't imagine how they're processing this stuff.
Are there any seeds in there at all?
Yeah, that's what throws me. There's no seeds, but that's from breeding. Like, that has nothing to do with how you're trimming or handling.
No, I get it, but I mean.
Unless you mix up your shit. But
when you get shake from your dealer, there's definitely a fair amount of seeds in it.
Shake, well, that would be more like swag. Like, they might be like, I got this seedy swag that you can have for 20. And be like, yeah, I'll take it. I'll pick it out. But, like, legitimate shake. Well, shit. Yeah, I didn't grind this one. I just blew my joint up. It's got some shrapnel in there still. You got to grind it up. That's all right. I got one good joint. I'll just go with this for now. I had to abort that one. But, yeah, I'm cheap, man. And, you know, okay, so... I should look it up, but gosh, it would take me too long to find it. I apologize. Next time, if I do this, I'll tag it or write it down. But there was a listener whose name I wish I could mention here, but I don't remember it. But he messaged us through Facebook.
Oh, Evan?
Was it Evan?
I think it's his name.
Yeah. He was just talking about his own. I think we were talking in the last episode about analog weed versus the concentrates and how it affects our behavior. And he was agreeing with that. He says that he has stuck with traditional, with flower, because it helps him control his usage. You know, he can't go to work and be blazing hooters all day. And he knows that if he got something discreet like the vape, that that's exactly what he would be doing. So it's interesting.
Which I wanted to say, well, yeah, that's exactly why you get the vape.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, Chris and I are thinking the exact opposite. Like, that's why we get, that's why we've gone vape. But, you know, everyone's different. Like, some people don't have that switch in their heads, regardless of whatever their addiction is. You know, and I'm open about this, you know, being an addiction. I have many addictions, like caffeine and sugar and THC. And it's about whether you have that switch in your head that, like, says full, but basically like a little trigger that says your tank's full, right? Like, I knew people back in the day when, you know, we'd go to parties and do all kinds of stupid drugs. And there were those people who was like, it's never enough, right? They're yeah. Like, I don't think this is, you take the same amount of drugs, have, you know, probably roughly the same tolerance, not a huge difference in build. And they're like, I'm not feeling it, but their eyes are rolling in the back of their head. They're chewing their fucking mouth off the inside of their mouth apart. And they're like, I don't feel it. I'm like, no, you feel it. You just convince yourself that it's not, you know, it's not enough and that more is going to be better. Like, just chill out. Just enjoy the ride, right?
Yeah.
And, but some people's brains are like that. You know, I'm not saying that that is the core of addiction, but that's like, seems to be a character trait of people who have addictive personalities. They don't have that. It's like when, you know, people who overeat, they don't have that connection. Something about what their gut and their brain talking to each other is not telling them, whoa, dude, like, we're full down here. Quit sending down more food.
Oh, I used to be like that. Like, when I was younger, I was never get full. Like, I get full now.
Right. Oops. So, yeah, if you've got an addictive personality, you know that you get that vape. You know, if I really tried and really wanted to be blown out 24/7, I could put one of these cartridges down in a couple days.
Yeah.
Well, no, cause but I don't.
It does get to a point where I'm like, man, I'm high.
Yeah.
Because, too, you got to get the right cartridge. Oh, which, by the way, I've run into live resin cartridges. Those are always nice.
Yeah, the live resin I've been getting lately, Stizzy. I've been getting a lot of Stizzy pods. I'm kind of a big fan of this because their batteries are really discreet.
You bought the device.
What's that?
Was it because you bought the device?
Well,
Stizzy device.
Sure. I got it free with, like, I think I bought like three of these and they gave me a free battery. And even then it was only like 20 or 25 bucks. Not like it's a huge investment. You know, if it wasn't working out really well, I'd ditch it. I've got a whole drawer full of devices that I don't use anymore. Vaping and all sorts of different, you know, contraptions. I used to have like a little, everything would fit in a cigar box.
Yeah.
Now I've got like a whole little, you know, it's like what a woman might have for her jewelry.
Damn, dude, I've been riding the same vape device since like last summer. Like, yeah. not this past summer, like COVID summer, 2020.
Sure. I've been about the same, but I've also added other devices.
Shout out to Yocan. Like, you make some durable shit, Yocan. Because I was used to batteries that you'd maybe get like 3 months out of, and then you'd have to buy another one.
You're not talking about for your nicotine vape. You're talking about the device, your battery that you hook up to your C-cells.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, so anyway, I got off track. I was talking about Stizzy. The reason I brought it up is because what they offer now, it's only like $5 more than the regular cartridge, is a CDT, a cannabis-derived terpenes. And it...
Charles, what now?
if you look into it, it seems to be like the same stuff as like live resin, only they're kind of going about the process back. I guess they separate it. They separate out like the THC and the terpenes, and then they and everything else that they don't want, and then they mix the terpenes back into the THC. And what you get is a vape that has a cannabis flavor to it. So it doesn't taste like alcohol, and it doesn't taste like some kind of flavoring. It actually tastes like vaporized weed. So it's pretty much the same experience as live resin. Why they don't offer just a live resin in the Stizzy, I don't know. Maybe something about that process.
Cost. I bet you that's the answer.
Might be cost. It might be cost. But maybe this is just a brand thing that I've ran into. But it seems like the live resin cartridges that I've got, the C-Cell live resin cartridges, clog more often than the non-live resin cartridges. And again, it might be, I didn't do an A-B comparison of like buy the same exact cartridge and here's, you know, one's live resin and one's not. It just seems like they clog up more often. And I think that maybe that's why Stizzy went with the CDT, because that allowed him to retain the consistency of the liquid.
I'm not gonna lie, I'm high as fuck.
Well, good.
I was trying to like so pay attention to everything you just said. Not this weed. I went to the dispensary the other day, and I picked up. I was like, fuck it. Like I feel like some analog weed, and I picked some up and I found some 27% THC on like the mid shelf.
That's pretty high.
Yeah. I was like, yeah, give me 2 grams of that. And yeah, I just smoked half of this joint and I am blew the fuck out. Well, I also smoked a joint of it before the show, but still.
That's another thing that I like about having the shake around is that I can, you know, roll up a joint of shake and I can actually get work done still if I need to. And then I can have, you know, if I really want to get blown out, I can buy some premium top shelf shit, just, you know, a gram of it and make a night of it. Oh.
I gotta like, I'm bordering on having to dude maintain myself.
What's your favorite animal?
Not to sidetrack. Well, it's a Weisman. Did you hear Adam Carolla hammered the other day?
Oh my God, he was.
He couldn't talk.
He was making me uncomfortable.
I was uncomfortable. I was laughing my ass off. I was like, up in there, bro.
I was uncomfortable for two reasons. One being that I am somebody who, you know, I'm not saying that we're on the same level as what Adam Carolla does, but we do a fucking lot of podcasts. I record my voice a lot. I put it out there. And I'm kind of, well, two things. I'm asthmatic and I'm lispy, especially when I get drunk. When I get drunk, the lisp really comes out, and I'm kind of self-conscious about that, mostly because it's a sibilant thing that sounds really harsh and annoying in the microphone, and that's why I almost forgot which one we were using, the RE20s that we have, that was just like the best investment for me, because these mics handle my voice and don't accentuate what do they call it? The sibilance of my voice as much as other like condenser microphones. And so I think I was embarrassed because like, I feel like, you know, that happens to me sometimes. I get really cotton mouthy and I start getting lispy or I start getting mush mouthy. And also I felt unsettled because he sounded more like he was having a fucking stroke. And he's like my grandpa. Right? He's like, not my grandpa, like he's fucking old, but like I grew up with Adam Carolla. It seems like he, you know, Loveline, ever since like I was a teen, it was around. And he's always been doing something that was like on my radar. And I just felt like he's not sick, is he? Right?
No, dude, he was hammered.
He was hammered. Yeah, I know. I know now.
Like, if you listen to the show, that they did like a half a dozen shots.
He says that he's drunk. He says he's drunk before he, but by the time they get to the end of the show, he's just like, pretty blotto.
They did a half a shot, dozen shots of whiskey. You should be drunk.
It happened so quickly, though, right? He seemed composed, and that's why it freaked me out, because it was like all of a sudden he started slurring his words and not finishing his sentences, and I'm like, that sounds like a stroke.
Well, isn't when you get drunk, you get high, you trip, isn't your controlled poisoning?
I guess, yeah.
I mean,
a stroke, I mean, essentially, it's kind of like a stroke or a seizure. It's like a brain glitch, you know, and all you're doing with drugs is creating usually some sort of synesthesia, some cross-wiring of your senses.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not as literal as, like, you know, I don't know, maybe drugs were different. Maybe acid was different back then and people actually could taste colors. But it's like, it's not about tasting colors. Here's my thing about, like, people talk about, you know, hallucinating on acid and stuff. Like, I've never, like, seen, like, a full figure of, like, a gnome come up and tug on my pant leg or some shit.
No, you'd see
animated. But you'd see the tree move in a way that
aren't supposed to move that way. Optical illusions is what I've seen. Like,
right.
Where the grass looks like fucking water.
And it's not that you could taste the color green on your tongue. It's that if somebody told you, wow, I can taste the color, you'd be like, yeah, man. Like, I know what you mean by that.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it's just nonsense, right?
Yeah. You know, I've seen the carpet. Carpet turn into fucking waves. I mean, we've all seen it. The fucking walls breathing. I mean,
it's optical illusions,
really.
Maybe you'll see a snake or something, but it's like fucking dark out.
Yeah.
And it was just a stick.
Yeah.
And it's not actually moving.
And it's out of the corner of your eye, too. It's not like...
Right, right. Yeah, it didn't pop up and start talking to you like you're in the fucking Jungle Book.
Yeah. Like, yeah, there are some, like, bad depictions of...
Hollywood treats weed like an acid trip, and acid trips like you've gone fucking insane.
Yeah, the only accurate depiction ever really was Fear and Loathing.
Yeah.
I mean, I never saw motherfuckers turn into lizards, but they were also on some, like, crazy other shit, too. Mm-hmm. They were not on just acid.
Yeah. Oh, I feel like we've gone down so many tangents. I was going to try and retrace my steps, but I think that's long gone. We should move forward. But is this our Halloween episode? No, I guess
it is.
Last week would have been... Oh, no, this is going to come out on Halloween, yeah.
I'm wearing fangs right now.
You're not.
If the listener... Nah, in the Halloween's... Not really. Of Black Cat.
This is Rory's week.
This is the. There you go.
Oh yeah.
7 days Black a cats. Year. You're a Halloween decoration cat. This is not a drill. You sit in the window. You're a fucking goddamn decoration now. When you're watching.
Do you have
TV.
A costume?
No. I'm only recently settling back into being able to have Halloween, because for 20 years all Halloween meant was I was gonna have to work really hard.
Oh, right.
In the business that I was in. It's the busiest day of the year, one of them.
Yeah.
It's like a day where you do half a week's business on like one day.
Yeah, so wow. This is the first time in a long time that Halloween actually doesn't mean like, oh, God.
Well, actually, I do have to work on Halloween.
Yeah.
Because my new job, it's the end of their week, and I have to learn like inventory. So, but apparently it's like not even, it's just another day. So,
I've got a Chewbacca costume that I might don. I got it from my ex. She dragged me on this treasure hunt.
Scavenger hunt?
It's scavenger hunt. Yes, thank you. There's a scavenger hunt. And she was like, oh, EO wants to do this, our youngest. And it's just her and I. Will you help us out? And then turns out, like, EO was, like, half into it, and she was, like, gung-ho. And so my enthusiasm level was based on my child's enthusiasm level. So when that started to wane, my interest was out the door. But we helped out. We, you know, I didn't have a costume, though. It was last minute. And she was like, well, would you wear this? And she had a Chewbacca costume. I'm like, well, fuck yeah. It wouldn't be the first time I wore a Chewbacca costume, actually.
Are you going to go, realistic Chewbacca sound? Yeah.
Well, this one is like a manufactured, like, zip-up thing with a, you know, Velcro sash that to represent the utility belt that Chewbacca has. I guess that's what you'd call it. Or maybe it's a utility sash.
Is it movie quality?
Yeah. It is not movie quality. Honestly, the one that I had as a kid was probably better. And that was made by my mother. It was done out of shag carpet remnants and duct tape. And that was pretty much it. She sewed together the costume out of the carpet and then duct taped together something that looked like the utility sash.
Huh. I had a Ghostbuster backpack made out of the box top from a box of paper and a vacuum hose.
That's nice.
I thought it was pretty fucking badass.
Not enough of those rigged up costumes. Like,
oh, everyone's parents giving a shit?
Well, yeah. Well, you know, like, parents give a shit, but giving a shit now means like, well, you're going to get the best guy. We're going to, you're going to get like some $300 custom fit. So you look exactly like movie replica Thor.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. Like,
or
looking at it now, we had some bullshit as a kid compared to what's available now.
Yeah. Or these dads like trying to get TikTok famous by like making these overly extravagant transforming things for their children. I mean, that's cool. And I'm sure the kids are thrilled about it. But what I really love is the like, we got to put something together out of pretty much what's in the house. And, you know, maybe you had like a box of, you know, masks and you know, funny glasses, maybe a wig, a nurse's hat, having to like ad hoc throw something together. I mean, for me, Halloween was like you've got only so many building blocks and you're not going to go out and buy a new costume every year. That's ridiculous. Who's got that kind of money? Who's got $10 for a plastic mask and a bib?
And essentially what it was.
Yeah. You know, you might be able, if you need like some plastic teeth or a little bit of fake blood, sure, you could get that. But you had to, you know, make what was due out of what you had. So, you know, you might have a full pirate costume next for 1 year and then the next year, it's like, okay, I'll wear the pig mask with the pirate hat. Now I'm a pig pirate. And then you're a zombie pig. And then you're a mummy. And then you're a zombie mummy pig. I don't know. I guess a zombie and a mummy would kind of be...
Man-bear-pig. I don't know
how you differentiate between those two. I don't know. We had a pig mask. I know that much. It was scary as fuck.
I had a Ninja Turtle mask.
I bet you that was scary. I've never seen anybody in a Ninja Turtle mask that didn't look scary as fuck.
It's a full head mask.
That's fucking fucked. That stay the fuck away from me.
It was Leonardo. I was disappointed.
They all look the same.
Michelangelo was always sold out because everyone wanted to be Michelangelo because he was the party dude. He's in the song.
Really? I thought Raphael was like that.
He was crude but rude. Come on, man.
Yeah, Raphael was the Wolverine of the Ninja Turtles, man. He was the one that everyone wanted to be when we played Ninja Turtles.
He's the asshole, essentially.
Exactly. Hey, it was the 90s. Assholes were in.
I know, right?
Okay.
It's the Dennis Leary of Ninja Turtles.
Yes.
Because remember, in the movie, he's the one who cursed.
Ooh.
Remember the live-action movie? The one,
I remember.
Dude, that shit came out when I was in middle school. Like, you know, if I had bowling alley sound effects, you know, right at me, you know, strike.
Premium, yeah.
So, yeah, no, remember? Because the big controversy, there's going to be cussing. And, yeah, Raphael said, like, ass or shit or something.
Yep. Yeah, I remember seeing that movie and liking it. It was a little late for me. You know, I was probably still... I don't know. What year was that that it came out again?
Stand by. I want to say I was in sixth grade, so 91, 92.
Yeah, so I was already in high school. So I remember going to see it, but at that time, if I had any Ninja Turtles, they were in a box in the basement. But probably not. I blew up most of my toys.
90.
Oh, 90? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was a freshman. I was probably pretty geeked about it. Oh, no, cool. So at the time when the movie came out, I wasn't into the toys, but I was playing the role-playing game a lot. The Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles role-playing game was fantastic because it was all Mad Max. It was set in a post-apocalyptic world, and you could do your character design based on, you know, what type of mutation you wanted to be. You could pick pretty much any animal. And there was a heavy emphasis on like vehicle combat.
Remember, Corey Feldman was Donatello. Or no, Corey Feldman was Michelangelo.
I didn't know he was any of them. That's a good question. Who did the voices for the original?
Stand by. Hey, it's on HBO Max.
Might be worth a spin. I try to think. The last time I watched it was not too long ago.
No, that's right. Corey Feldman was Donatello. Judith Hogue. Here you go. Cast.
What? As April?
April O'Neil.
Okay.
Corey Feldman, Donatello, Elias. Oh, fucking. Oh, shit. No, never mind. Elias Cote. Isn't that... it's not the warden from Orange is the New Black, is it? Casey Jones? No. He's a guy who looks like him. Like, nobody we know.
Oh, Elias Koteas? How do you
yes.
say? What the fuck has he been in? I know this guy from, like, so much shit. He's like... He's in the Thin Red Line.
Sam Rockwell? Like, that Sam Rockwell?
Was he Raphael?
No, it says head thug.
Oh, really? It probably was that Sam Rockwell. Josh Pius. No, wait a minute. Dude, that's,
No, oh, shit! That Sam Rockwell was in the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie. It says as head thug, so some little shit part. Oh, Kevin Clash. The guy who played Elmo was Splinter. Then he ended
up... Josh, did you ever watch, Ray Donovan?
No.
I know this guy's been in other shit.
Oh, Skeet Ulrich was in it. He was thug number one. That is interesting.
Yeah, Josh Pais was, he plays, or Pais, I'm not sure how to pronounce that name, P-A-I-S. He plays, I don't know, he's like a lawyer or something that hires Ray Donovan, who, if you've never seen the show, he's like a fixer guy. And he's always getting himself into trouble, and Ray Donovan, like, in... He breaks his hand one time by shoving it into the hole in a pool table and then just, like, leaning on his arm.
Is that possible?
Yeah, I guess. And look at, he's been in everything, but I'm not seeing anything that is, like, a prominent role where I could point to and be like, no, you know him from this guy in this show. Like, he's on one episode of The Sopranos. He pops up on Law and Order. He's on... Two Broke Girls, yeah, The Good Wife.
He's one of those character actors.
Yeah, he was on, Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll, which was the short-lived Dennis Leary show.
Mm-hmm.
He's on High Maintenance. He was in Joker. He's going to be in the upcoming DMZ based on a very good comic book.
The DMZ, like the Demilitarized Zone?
Yes. That's what it stands for, yep.
The Weedsman Podcast. ChristopherMedia.net.
When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more. When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more.
ChristopherMedia.net.
The Weedsman Podcast.
Did you see that shit about Adam Levine getting criticized for his reaction to having a fan run up on stage and hug him?
Yeah, and you know what? Two-word answer to that for people who are giving him a hard time. Dimebag Daryl.
Yeah, a very good point.
Dimebag Daryl got shot on fucking stage while he was playing. Adam Wright has a right to be fucking startled. I'm just saying, there's like situations like that. People are fucking nuts now.
Yeah, did you see his reaction? Did you watch the video?
I did not.
I would take a look at it. It's pretty exaggerated. I heard it described, and I was like, oh, it seems legit, and I don't know why people are reacting that way. When I watch it, I can still kind of understand his reaction, but I also definitely understand where the fans are coming from, because he doesn't just jump and he's not just startled by it. He goes, what the fuck? And then, like, visibly, like, shakes. Like, I gotta, like, shake that off me and move on. And she just does, like, a real sweet, comes up and kind of grabs his arm like she wants to hang on to him for a second. Like, not one of these, you know, back in the day, if somebody was, you know, bum-rushing Axl Rose at a show, they'd be, like, shirt off, full-on, trying to straddle him on stage, and security would have to peel her off.
To be fair, Adam... Or Axel is usually the one doing the bum rushing.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. I believe there were several incidents where he leapt into the crowd.
But yeah, I understand his reaction from the point of, you know, he's in a very controlled environment, and for very good reasons, right? There has to be a clear delineation between here's where the talent is and here's where the visitors are. There's not a lot of areas where you're mingling.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, like, you know, some rando is right there next to you, like, hi. How you doing your job?
Yeah.
How much you making right now?
Yeah.
Like, get the fuck like, out get of the here. Fuck out? Yeah. Dude, I went to so one of my favorite DJs,
it's
local
legend.
It's a
social contract thing, though, too. Yeah. Right? Like, I'm up here, you guys stay down there. Like, don't fuck with me.
One of my favorite DJs, local legend Claude Young, and he's played a lot of shows in town recently that I've had the pleasure of seeing. And one of them is at Spotlight, which is kind of a more laid-back club. And it's very open, and there's where the DJ tables are. It's just kind of, it's just a rug, and there's not like a booth. It's not closed off. I mean, they kind of have it separated off with like couches and stuff, but you know, anybody could walk back there. The only reason people don't hang out back there is because it would be rude to be in the DJ's way. But some guy, while Claude was playing, shows up behind him. Like, he just walks over, pops up behind him, and kind of leans in and is smiling and like acts like he's going to touch the, I was going to say record player, but they're all digital now. Touch the CDJ. And these three girls that are like in front of the booth are all have their cameras up and they're taking video of them. And I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? Get out of there.
Yeah, I mean, people are nutty now, man.
Like, he was doing it. This went on for like 30 seconds probably before somebody from the bar walked over and was like, get out of here.
Yeah.
And the guy was pissed. What? I'm just having fun. I'm just hanging out. Like, yeah, he's working.
Yeah, let this guy be. Let him do his thing.
I know DJ just seems like a cool thing that you can do if you buy, you know, a couple grand worth of equipment. And you can be one too. And go ahead, dude. Like, more power to you. Go be a DJ. It's not that hard.
It's true. There's some dumb motherfuckers who've learned.
You want somebody to
DJ.
Take your picture while you have your hand on a quote unquote record while you tweak a knob and wave your hand in the air, then learn how to beat match. Shit. I mean, if you want to be a good DJ, that's a lot more work. But if you just want to be a DJ, fuck. Dime a dozen, man.
It's true. Said I'd known some dumb motherfuckers who knew how to be a DJ.
Sorry. It's a little personal for me because, like, even in an, even if that, if what was going on in that area was a live band and it was, you know, kind of open like that, but, you know, there's clearly a space where here's where the performers are, you wouldn't just go up and be like, oh, I'm going to start. Can I touch the neck of your guitar and just act like I'm playing it too?
No. Oh, God. I used to hate that.
You wouldn't do
that.
You wouldn't do it.
Can I touch your guitar? No, you cannot.
But, like, no, but, like, while you're playing it, like, while you're on stage, just get up there. Not get up and be like, yeah, and do a stage dive. Be like, yeah, I'm going to pretend like I'm playing your instrument for a second here and while my girlfriend takes my picture.
No, you are not.
It's outrageous. It's outrageous. Yeah.
I want, because that's the other thing too, is you just wonder if that fucking idiot did that too. So fucking, you know, one of her idiot friends could put her on Instagram. Got on stage with Adam Levine tonight.
I don't know what you're thinking. I mean, how did the fuck did she get on stage, and what did she think was going to happen?
Right. Yeah. What are you going to do? Duet?
Because it's not like it's some kind of rowdy show.
Yeah.
You know. You go to a ministry concert, you know how somebody ends up on stage.
Partying.
They were, yeah, crowd surfing, went over the barrier, jumped up. Maybe they tried to go up on stage on purpose. I mean, the only times that I've jumped up on a stage that I wasn't supposed to be performing on was when I wanted to run to the front of it and dive out into the crowd.
Did you?
Oh, yeah.
Never done that.
You've never done...
I'll trust other people that much.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's got to be the right environment, but yeah.
Also imagine there's a lot of fingers going everywhere. Hmm. Cool on the Digital Violation by Strangers. Digital Violation, new band name, I call it.
I like that. That's got a nice ring to it. What else is going on? Not music news. Like ABBA breaking up, which I didn't know that they had gotten back together.
Yeah.
You're in your 70s.
Yeah.
Why are you telling it? But apparently they've announced a tour. They're releasing an album that's coming out soon.
Oh, and then this is it.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why. They're like, because hey, we're 70.
Well, I guess it does seem more practical. I mean, like the Rolling Stones always talk about, like, no, we're just going to keep going on forever until I guess all of us are dead.
Right. Well, one down.
And when they do a new album, they're like, oh, yeah, no. We're like, we've never felt so alive when we're in the studio and whatever. Like, you know, we're just full of creative energy still, and age is nothing but a number.
Number ain't nothing but a thing.
Wouldn't you want to have, like, you know, if you know that it... I mean, obviously, you got to figure time's finite.
Mm-hmm.
And there's only... I don't know. There's only so many songs an artist has in them, I think. Why not just go, let's concentrate on getting like one good album and that's it?
Their one good album was 50 years ago, though.
True. But, well, how many albums has ABBA done?
Let's see here.
Because there's a, you know, there's been a lot of artists out there that have sold a lot of records and made a lot of records. They've made a lot of records and sold a lot of records. I think they might have one of the highest averages in pop music, though. Now, it's hard to parse when you look at it because there's so much of this is like greatest 15? Hits. Like actual studio albums filtering out, like, because some of these were like re-releases of material that for different countries and different regions. Let's see, live albums.
It looks like their last album came out in 94?
I think it's less than 10 actual albums. I mean, their discography is as long as the day is, but it's all re-releases and gold and...
Counting them, it looks like 10.
I mean, yeah, I think that's right. It's just that they're, you know, because their music has sold so well pretty consistently over the decades, that, you know, the stuff is just always in print and always being re-released and repackaged and all that. So out of 10 albums, and just take ABBA Gold, Not a Loser, amongst those 18 tracks.
I really only know this.
That's pretty solid, man. That is pretty solid. Dude, you don't know Take a Chance on Me, Lay All Your Love on Me, Money, 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 Mamma Mia, Super Trooper, Knowing Me, Knowing You, Gimme, Gimme, Gimme a Man After Midnight. That's my favorite, man. That's the banger. With those fucking
According to YouTube Music, that is the banger.
That's the banger. I'm just saying, like, what I appreciate about ABBA is, like, they just seem like they're so focused as songwriters. You know, it wasn't just about...
Didn't, like, Madonna redo this song?
Probably.
Somebody redid this song.
Yeah. I don't know. There's a lot of great acts that cranked out a lot of music. You know, especially if you look at acts in like the 60s and 70s, when Adam Carolla was talking to Donny Osmond and he was telling him about the year that he put out 4 albums in 1 year with 2 different groups. And that wasn't that unheard of. You know, they had artists had contracts for putting out 2 albums a year.
Oh yeah. Our Beatles conversation that didn't make it into last show. We were talking about, they would put out 2 albums a year.
Mm-hmm. Beatles also had the luck of having a lot of good songwriters.
Yes.
You know, not every band had that. So instead you'd get, you know, a couple good songs and then the rest of it's like, oh, that's all right. Like, honestly, if you took the 4 albums they put out over 2 years and condense that down into 1 album, it might be pretty fantastic for a lot of those acts.
Yeah. But I mean, this was back to when bands they'd put out at least an album a year.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, I'm not really solid on my history of the band, but it just seems like they had a lot of control over what they did at all times. They not only knew exactly what it was they wanted to do, like what type of pop they wanted to do and how they thought it would, you know, appeal to the masses, not just, you know, local Swedish people, but all across the world. And they don't seem like the type of act that was controlled all the time by a label and being forced to like crank out and music and tour.
So I'm going to guess you've seen the Mamma Mia movie?
No. I hate musicals. I love ABBA. I already know all the music. The Mamma Mia isn't about ABBA at all. Like, I don't think anybody even talks about ABBA in it.
Right.
So, why? Like, because they sing songs that I know? Not even my... Like...
No, I mean, like, I saw Rock of Ages. That movie's a piece of shit.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, cool.
Most musicals are.
Well, it's because it's a jukebox musical, too. This could help us segue into something else. It's got Alec Baldwin in it.
Oh, jeez. What, you want to talk about that again? Didn't we already address that?
No. I don't think it happened. I think it happened after we recorded.
I don't know, man. I don't know what there is to say about that. It's just a tragedy.
This is crazy.
I think what's the only thing that I find like really disgusting about it is like, I think it was in the New York Post, you know, a paper that is not really friendly to liberals in general, and certainly not to somebody like, even though like you know, it's not like Baldwin's the most liberal guy in the world, but he, you know, he did the no-no of making fun of the dear leader. And so now he's fair game. And so their sub-headline on it, he was, I guess, spotted, quote-unquote, and then like somebody saw him living. Right. He was spotted somewhere in upstate New York, even though, and their sub-headline was, even though the police say they have, quote, no idea where he is.
He's not going to be charged with anything.
Right. You know why the police have no idea where he is and why they said that? Because somebody asked them and they said, no, why? Why do we need to know where Alec Baldwin is? Are we afraid he's going to flee the country over this?
Yeah. Yeah, it's dumb how it became political. Like, really? This is really?
Like, I think he bears responsibility as a producer of the movie, but not on any level. Like, I think he should be charged with manslaughter or something. Like, I'm sure he's paying that already. I can't imagine what he's going through.
Yeah, it's got to be messed up.
You know,
he accidentally killed somebody,
and he could have just fucking, you know, ruined the. Not that Alec Baldwin couldn't go on to just live a fine life in isolation with all the money I hope he has. But, you know, he seems to love what he was doing, and he could have fucked all that up.
I think he'll still work.
I think he will, too, but can't you imagine? I mean, put yourself in his position. I think after I'm done with, like, holy fuck, I've inadvertently taken a life and ruined, you know, a whole family.
Yeah.
After I got over that, my second thought would be, I fucked my career. How am I going to work again after I've shot my director or my DP, both?
I mean, he's 58. He's made good money.
Sure. But is that how you want to end your career?
Go out with a bang.
No.
Ah, too soon.
Only thing that could come out of this good is if they actually do some reform on the handling of these weapons and even having them on set, like all the things they can do with movies.
Well,
there's no reason to have a working gun on set, much less ammunition.
Yeah, what's the live ammo doing there? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, apparently there's some target practice happening. The thought was maybe they were trying to like, hey, here's how the gun would kick in real life so that, you know, they're going for realism. So mm-hmm. When they fire the weapons, they want to reproduce that kick that they would get from a live round.
Mm-hmm.
Make it look real.
Can understand that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's called YouTube. Look it up. Watch a video of somebody firing a weapon. You don't need a live round. You don't need a live gun.
Yeah.
Just look it up and go, oh, it looks like this. Okay. I'll just do that.
It's a messed up situation.
Messed up all the way around. I mean, even just for the people involved in that were just there working, right? They didn't come to. They came to work to see people get fake killed.
Yeah, and then they got real killed. Baldwin is one of those guys. Like, no matter how much a dick of he is off screen, I like his work. I don't understand it. Like that means he's a good actor, right?
Sure. Yeah, I can't say that everything that he's done has blown me away, but he's kind of the opposite of Nick Cage, right? Nick Cage does some schlock and he does some brilliant stuff. Apparently Pig is brilliant, but whatever he did before that probably wasn't. Whereas Alec Baldwin just kind of rides right down the middle. Sure, you can point to like, oh, he was great in Glengarry Glen Ross, but that's just one snazzy part that you remember because, you know, it's a good monologue.
That isn't even in the play?
He wasn't in the play, and he's not in the movie for long. He has the one scene. Like, people know Alec Baldwin from Alec Baldwin. Huh. Yeah, he's been in movies. He was in that thing. He's got the family. He was dating the woman. I don't know. Like, it's Alec Baldwin.
It's a hell of
he's
a monologue, 30 Rock.
Oh, sure. I'm not trying to, like, classify talent. I'm trying to classify like perception, and yeah, I just think like he's not done anything like that's like super phenomenal, But he also hasn't done anything that I think is garbage.
I don't think he gets enough credit for Jack Donaghy.
I'll put it this way. From my recollection, everything that Alec Baldwin has been in is watchable. It's not an insult. Well, because everything that Nick Cage has been in is not watchable.
I guess too. I guess yeah. If you're
somebody goes, where do I start with Nick Cage? I have a very specific list.
Yeah.
I'm not going to go, oh, it's all good.
True.
Somebody's interested.
You listen, like start and end with Raising
Alec
Arizona.
Baldwin. I don't know, like fucking yeah. I don't. He hasn't been in anything that's not worth watching. So just start anywhere.
He's in Beetlejuice.
Yeah.
Everyone forgets that. It's Halloween time.
Right. Well, here's the thing. Like, he's good in Beetlejuice. Beetlejuice is a good movie, but nobody talks about, like, oh, Alec Baldwin in Beetlejuice. Oh, that's some next level shit. Oh, what he's doing in that movie.
Well, he's just a straight man.
He's doing a serviceable job as the straight man. He does a great job. I mean, he's just, for the longest time, he was just a chin.
Yeah.
Right? He was just like, man, this guy's got, like, face for days, and that's what the big screen loves. Big faces, and man, he's got it. But that
he's the original
again,
Jack
Ryan.
I think he's got talent.
I think he's got talent. I think he's he puts his heart into everything that he does, and he I think it shows. I think that Nicolas Cage has talent. It's just a different type of talent.
And the gambling habit.
Ooh, here's an analogy for you.
Oh,
let's see if you agree with this, and if I can put it together. All right. Alec Baldwin is Bruce Springsteen and Nick Cage is nasally guy.
What?
singer. Bob Dylan. Right? Bruce Springsteen puts out a whole string of albums that are pretty much middle of the road AC rock and they're good. Yeah, but they're good. I don't like Bruce Springsteen either, but I'm not like, he's a shitty artist. He's a good artist that does art that I don't appreciate.
Okay.
Would you agree with that statement?
Yes.
Yeah. So just like, I'm trying to take opinion out of this. Like, so, whereas, Bob Dylan, he's got some stuff that's like just really schlocky and maybe, a little too religious. And then he'll do something that's like, really phenomenal. I like, out of his newer stuff, I kind of like the contemporary pieces that he's doing, like the Sinatra stuff that he's gotten into more lately. But I agree. Yeah. Mostly you stick to the 60s stuff, but there's like big highs and lows, right? There's huge peaks to his music. And then there's like, stay away from that stuff. And there's not really that with Bruce Springsteen's catalog. It's like, yeah. If somebody goes, where do I start with Bruce? Yeah. Pick an album. I don't know. They all sound like Bruce.
Somewhere there's a Springsteen fan that probably wants to smack you.
Yes, but here's how analogies work. It's not that I'm saying that if you like Bruce Springsteen that you're going to like Alec Baldwin and vice versa.
No, I meant just more that you're saying like, it all sounds the same. Pick one. I'm saying that as far as I know...
Real fans would be like, you got to start with like...
There are no casual fans
Nebraska.
Of the boss, I guess is what I'm getting at.
And they'll give you a playlist.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Like, I don't know. I had a friend asked about Autechre, which is a really weird techno band. And they were like, I've heard this name and kind of interested. Where do I start? And another common friend was like, I think you should start here and maybe listen to this and that. And I was just like, chronologically? Like, I don't know. Like, because...
I think that's how you should always approach a band. But that's just me.
I think I do that because I want to... If I hear a band pops up out of nowhere with a song that I think is phenomenal and I find out that they've got four albums... I'm more likely to go back and listen to that first album before I listen to the entirety of their latest album because I'm curious about, like, how did they get there?
My God, what have I done?
Sorry. But,
you know, not everyone listens to music in the same way or for the same reasons. We are musicians and we listen to music for enjoyment, certainly, but we also can't turn off that analytical side of our brain. Actually, if you're not watching the Wu-Tang show, the American Saga, it just wrapped up its second season. Just fucking get Hulu for a month, even if that's all you need to do, and just binge watch those two seasons because it's just phenomenal. I think anyone who's a musician of any sort would really appreciate this. And there's that episode, I think I talked about it before, where he breaks down a record in his mind and, you know, isolates parts inside of his head and, like, analyzes them. Like, yeah, that's how musicians think about music, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, certain people look at a car, like, you crack a hood on a car and people can look at it and go, yeah, that's an engine.
Mm-hmm.
Mechanics look at it and they see it all mapped out before them.
Yeah.
They see all the parts and they see how it all works.
They know what's connected, you know, to what and what it does and why it's there.
Right. Or if I look at the back of your mixer, you know, I don't need a brochure to tell me what a mixer does. Show me the back panel and I'll tell you exactly what it does and how to hook it up. It's all laid out there. You know, that's because I'm trained to see those patterns. I'm trained to see those things. You know, most people just see the thing, you know, a good pop song. I don't know. Yeah. What is it made out of? I don't know. Synthesizers and shit. I don't know. I just know that it sounds good. And that's all you have to be. Like, and it's, sometimes it's a detriment, right? Sometimes I feel like I don't enjoy music enough because I'm constantly like, well, it seems like they're using a lot of this or that on it.
You know too much. See, you've been behind the curtain. Yeah, right. I understand it completely.
And wow, this really sounds a lot like Belle and Sebastian. And then you find out, oh, they've got a member, and oh, that's what's going on here. Oh, this ex-member of that band is in this one. That's why they're doing this. Or you could just enjoy it or not for what it is, right?
Oh, I mean, yeah, when I was in a band, it was awful trying to listen to music because all you do is just analyze. Yeah.
Especially, you know, if you're in a struggling band, listening to new music can be infuriating.
That too. Like,
because
really?
Either way, like you get your lid blown off and then you're like, oh, fuck. I'm never going to be able to do that.
Yeah.
Or something sells a million and you listen to it and you go, why the fuck is that selling? And I can't fucking sell a CD.
Yeah. You're like, this sounds some shit we wrote and threw away. And we're like, eh, whatever. Yeah.
The Weedsman Podcast. ChristopherMedia.net.
When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more.
Look, staying healthy isn't easy. Watching your diet, hitting the gym, avoiding stress. But a good night's rest helps boost your overall health and wellness. And it couldn't be easier. The Sleep Number 360 Smart Bed effortlessly adjusts in response to both of you. The result? You wake up ready for anything. Proven quality sleep is life-changing sleep. And now save $1,000 on the Sleep Number 360 Special Edition Smart Bed. Only for a limited time. To learn more, go to sleepnumber.com.
When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more. When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit RoyalCaribbean.com to learn more.
ChristopherMedia.net.
The Weedsman Podcast.
So, what else? I guess we could talk about weed, huh?
Is there any news in the reefer department?
I don't know. Well, it seems to be a lot going on around the deltas. There's going to be as many, I predict in the future, there will be as many strains of COVID as there are of Delta versions of THC.
Was Delta 8 THC the new hotness for middle-aged
Delta
mom?
10. Oh. Delta 10 is the new one, actually. Delta 8's already become an old news.
Well, if you don't know shit until you're on a Delta 10.
But yeah, Delta 8 or your diet weed, as they sometimes call it, that's the version of cannabis that's been banned in Texas, although there are a lot of shops that are pushing back against that now. One of them, Houston-based smoke shop Vape City, they had an attorney to represent them, and
Vape City!
Oh, I guess they have more than 75 retail stores.
Oh, wow.
Texas is a big state.
Yes and no. I mean, it's a huge state, but where
not,
the people
not a lot
are,
of people.
Yeah, right. Where the people are is scattered,
right?
But damn, 75 locations. I guess, hell yeah, they just own all the vape stores.
So they filed a request for a temporary restraining order this week, asking the judge to remove Delta 8 THC from the Texas Department of State Health Services list of Schedule 1 controlled substances. What are they basing their argument off of, though? Failure to give proper notice. This sounds like it's just a stalling tactic to keep in business, hoping that the tide will turn on this.
I mean, I don't get why it's such a...
It's a low THC version of cannabis that technically isn't regulated.
It's something for middle-aged moms to get worked up about.
Well, cannabis in general is. You
know? Yeah.
Well, look, I think, I don't know. I don't know if things like Delta 8 or this new like Delta 10 are going to be popular. I don't. They'll probably just be able to constantly reconjigger the molecule and come up with it. It's like how they get around like patent laws for medicines and stuff. You know, they just reorder it and they're like, oh, does the same thing. Okay, well, now we got a patent for our own boner drug.
I guess so.
Like, I just think, I don't know, I'm trying to put two things together here, but like we've got weed legalization and, you know, people calling for the government to make a call on cannabis and remove it from Schedule 1. And then we've also got all these other cannabis products coming up in the market that they're trying to play whack-a-mole with and make decisions on, well, is this, you know, is this comparable to cannabis or not? Or is it more like CBD? And should we be regulating it or not? And between all the different types of CBD products and just the handful of Delta variants, I know that's something that we use for COVID a lot now,
right.
But these Delta variants of THC, of Delta 8, Delta 9, Delta 10, you know, this might just turn into a constant game of whack-a-mole where, you know, we're probably just going to see the status quo for a lot longer than we thought. It's not necessarily that all progress is on the same exponential path where first of all, there's only so many states that can open up. But it's I think there's a plateau to it eventually because you're going to – at a certain point, you'll satisfy the mass market enough with the – with the retail side of it, and that'll be it. Like, and you'll just continue to have a thriving black market alongside of that, and these products like CBD products and Delta products in gas stations all over the place. And to me, it's like, you know, if you're going to sell, it's one thing to sell alcohol, right? But there's also products with alcohol in it. Just wouldn't recommend drinking them.
Yeah.
But you don't have to be 18 to buy mouthwash. You know, if you really wanted to, you could drink enough mouthwash to get yourself fucked up. Don't do it.
Minty fresh. Minty fresh and fucked up. Now, yeah, if you're drinking mouthwash to get hammered, it's time to maybe do personal inventory.
Yes.
Do you ever have Avalanche? I wonder if they still even make that.
What's Avalanche?
Remember how? Do you remember Aftershock? It was like really intense.
What are we talking about? Mouthwashes?
No.
What's booze. Avalanche? Okay, thank you. So, what are these?
Aftershock was really intense cinnamon schnapps, and Avalanche was its mint cousin.
No, I liked Goldschlager.
Ooh. Yeah, definitely drank my share of that in high school as well. But yeah, Avalanche was essentially, I always felt like I was getting hammered on mouthwash.
Yeah, no, I've never had any kind of like, I've tasted minty alcohol before, but never been a fan.
Yeah, I haven't had it since, put it that way. That's just before I could legally buy alcohol. Oh, underage drinking.
So here's a report from Leafly. They have a breakdown of like Delta 8 and Delta 10. Delta 9, if you don't know, is your traditional THC.
Oh, so regular ass, the weed we're smoking is Delta 9?
Yeah. So let's say, how does it feel? Many of the Delta 10 products you see online are actually a mix of Delta 8 and Delta 10. Delta 10 usually synthesized from CBD in very tiny amounts.
Well, wait. If Delta 8's one less, then is Delta 10 super weed?
No. After using both products, I'm sad to tell you, Delta 10 didn't hit for shit. That's straight from the Leafly's mouth here.
Boo this man.
Started the day with Delta 10 before consuming any other types of THC, so I knew how high I felt. Maui Wowie Delta 10 vape cartridge, and then some Delta 8 plus Delta 10 gummies later in the evening. And they say that they ended up feeling pretty much nothing, not even a slight change in body.
Delta 9 all the way.
Here's what I've never understood about it, though. Is this a difference in how they're processing it? I mean, I thought that's what it was, but they're talking about cannabis, like actual flower. So it's actually just... Like, how do you know what you're growing to that level that, like, I don't know. I don't know how they grow this shit. They literally just, like, this seed is a Delta 8 seed, and then they grow a Delta 8 plant.
So it's not even like they extract it?
I'm asking. I don't know. I'm asking. Because I always thought, because so much of this stuff that we read about now is all from the processing of THC. You know, that's how everyone got into CBD and the terpenes and all that stuff. So I just kind of assumed that this Delta stuff was just another offshoot of that. But then when I actually thought about it, I'm like, no, people, they're saying that they're buying actual joints that are Delta 8 and smoking it like regular cannabis. So it has to be just a different breed of plant. Unless they're doing that thing where they just grow like some hemp and then, you know, process something else down to Delta 8 and then spray it on there.
Or it could all just be a bunch of crap.
Yeah. It could just be shitty weed. And they're like,
yeah, it's Delta 8.
We could sell this joint of shake for $5, or we could sell this joint of Delta 8
for $7.
For $7. That's right.
Because it's Delta 8. Ooh, what's Delta 8? Try it and see.
Yeah.
Are there any, if you found the yearly story of don't hand out edibles this Halloween, make sure we're not handing out the edibles.
No. Well, no, it's, the stories aren't, they're not about don't hand out your edibles. It's make sure that, you know, people aren't giving your kids edibles in their Halloween candy is usually what comes up. But no, I haven't seen one.
Yeah, they're not, because guess what? Nobody buys that many edibles at one time.
No. Well, even, I think there's one story where a guy stuck needles in some fun-sized Snickers and gave them out to kids, and he did it because he was a fucking sicko. And other than that...
And it's perpetuated this forever?
Every other story about, you know, razor blades and poison and stuff, that's all either been completely debunked or turns out it was some other shit going on. There was one, there was a story about, there's a young kid who got into their uncle was staying with them, with the family, and the uncle was a heroin addict. And the young kid had gotten into the heroin and was messing around with it and OD'd and died. And they covered it up by sprinkling heroin over his Halloween candy and being like, I don't know what happened.
Wow.
And that's probably where a lot of this starts. Like, oh, they're going to dose your kids.
Kids are bringing home rocks.
Yeah. Like, kids ain't getting my drugs. So
Charlie Brown got an actual rock. You never watched The Great Pumpkin? I got a this. I got a rock.
Like, who would get?
Yeah, right.
Like what's the thinking here? Like the adults are, well, they'd be like, womp, 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 womp. But the translation would be like, here comes that bald fuck again. Jesus Christ. Yeah, this kid thinks he's getting candy from us.
Fuck no.
Jesus. Well, look at the size of that goddamn head. I can't even look directly at it. It's giving me a headache.
You know what? Next year I'm shitting in this bag.
Give this kid a rock and maybe I'll stop coming over here. This fucking lunkhead.
Yeah. If the rock doesn't work, I'm shitting in the bag next year.
Yeah.
Did he just...
Fucking,
did they keep going with the gag? Did he have a bag of rocks?
I just want a skit. Like, somebody needs to make it, like, SNL or somebody.
Yeah.
Somebody needs to make, like, asshole parents that are just sitting there watching kids walk up. Like, look at these pieces of shit. Oh, fuck these little entitled... Look at them. Look at that costume. What the fuck are you supposed to be? Yeah. And then they open the door. Oh, you're so cute. Oh, you have a sticker.
I don't think he could do that now. I think that's too.
Close the door.
That's Gen X humor.
Yeah, one of them smelled. Did you BO on that one?
Did you see that kid's fucking costume?
Yeah. What do you expect? You put your.
You call that a pirate?
The neighborhood in a fucking garbage bag. Of course they're gonna sweat up a storm.
You know, just putting an eye patch on a kid doesn't make him a fucking pirate.
Yeah.
Oh, that kid really lost an eye. Oh no.
I wanted to be...
Oh, a fireworks accident? Oh, shit.
I wanted to put together... I still probably could. If I can find some snow camo pants and a really beat-up leather jacket and an eye patch, then I could be Snake Plissken. Now, no Kurt Russell.
What are you going to save us?
But I could pull it off.
You help us escape from L.A.?
I could be at least recognizable as that guy... Thinks he's Snake Plissken.
New York was first, right? It was Escape from New York.
Yeah, that's the original. I've never seen L.A.
Was it L.A. the 90s one?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. There was a pretty big gap between the two of them.
Mm-hmm. No, I remember the
original is a classic.
I remember L.A. because it was a big rock soundtrack.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
That's odd. I thought it was a... Well, what's his nuts? Who did Escape from New York?
John Carpenter.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, John Carpenter's a composer.
Oh, no, but the soundtrack, though, Stabbing Westward, Tool, White Zombie, The Toadies, Butthole Surfers, Sugar Ray, back when they were a rock band, Gravity Kills, Tori Amos, Ministry, Orange 9mm, Clutch,
Orange 9mm,
Sex Pod, Deftones, like...
It's not a bad soundtrack,
actually.
But the Escape from New York, the music was done by John Carpenter, as he did for... I thought he did that for all of his movies, but there's probably some bigger ones where he didn't. Where he actually had them scored. But he's a composer. He does all that great synth work on his movies. What a cast in that original, too. Kurt Russell, Lee Van Cleef, Ernest Borgnine, Donald Pleasence, Isaac Hayes, Harry Dean Stanton, and Adrian Barbeau.
Primus has a song called Lee Van Cleef.
None of those people, except for, Isaac Hayes was famous, but not for that. Donald Pleasence was a known name, and Ernest Borgnine. But those weren't guys in their prime. Those were, like, the two that he picked up and was like, you know, give some gravitas to my movie.
Yeah.
I don't know that Lee Van Cleef was ever in anything big. He just played an asshole. He was like a professional asshole for the entire like 70s and 80s.
Hey, you know, the world needs those people.
Well, Luxembourg is going to be become the first European country to legalize cannabis.
Oh, really?
Or at least they're looking to be.
Little tiny Luxembourg.
I wish I could visit Luxembourg. I think I would like that place. It's like France, but not really.
I believe that is that's the official motto of the country. It's like France, but not really.
Or you're like it's printed Dutch on the money. Of, or I don't know. I'm not really sure what Luxembourg is. I couldn't point to it on a map.
Could you be Luxembourgian?
I know the accents are sexy.
You're probably like a French German Danish hybrid. But they're saying, enough, let's just finally...
What are they saying? The idea is that a consumer is not in an illegal situation if he consumes cannabis, and that we don't support the whole illegal chain from production to transportation to selling, where there is a lot of misery attached. We want to do everything we can to get more and more away from the illegal black market. So a little bit, kind of clunky from the translation. But the same basic reasons normal thinking humans, say that it's high time for legalization because it's smartly saying that, you know, she calls out the violence that revolves around the black market. And, you know, a lot of politicians in the U.S. don't talk about that because they feel like the general public can't distinguish between the violence around the black market and thinking that the violence is around cannabis itself, you know, or just drugs.
Wikipedia's map fails.
What? You couldn't even find Luxembourg with Google?
Well, I didn't start with Google, but it looks like it's surrounded by Germany, Denmark, and France.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
Well, I just typed it into my status bar, and the whole Luxembourg thing came up for Wikipedia, and I went through there.
All right, well, that's all I've got. Oh, I did see Dune.
I heard you and Rich had a mandate.
Rich and I got high as giraffe pussy.
Nice.
I had everything. I smoked a joint on the way down there, and then we ate a bunch of edibles. And
oh, wow.
I was vaping. And we went to the IMAX theater, which is like kind of IMAX, but not quite.
IMAX.
It was worth it, dude. It was a big screen. And I'm glad I watched it for the first time in the theater. It's a little slow and it's kind of weird that like it's structured where, you know, it's like a 3-hour movie. And in the halfway point, there's this huge battle. So then you've got like the other half of the movie on the back end of this huge battle where it's like, now we walk the desert. And I don't know. I just think that they should have. I understand that's probably how like the movie's kind of chronological. It doesn't jump around a lot. I'm sure that's how it was laid out in the book as well. But I just feel like, you know, there's a reason why it's such a, it's almost a trope in movies to start in media res, like, you know what that means? It's basically you're starting in the action. So, you know, movie starts, there's a chase scene. Why are they being chased? And, you know, and then you find out who it is at the end. And then they're like, here I am, you know, escaping another hairy situation. Probably wondering how I got here. Well, blah, 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 blah. And then they go back and tell a story about how they got there. You know, so I just feel like the movie should have been like, you know, open on people looking like they've been walking through the desert for an hour and a half in movie time and have, you know, some brief overdub of Timothy Chalamet telling me why him and his mother have been walking around the desert forever and then probably wondering how we got here. Back up to here's the planet, here's the spice wars and blah, blah, blah. But I don't know. It's beautiful. It's a really beautiful movie. And it's cool as fuck.
I guess telling Rich yesterday, I have no. I the only thing I know is Sting was in the original movie. That's all I know.
Yeah, I mean, like the David Lynch one is crazy. It's a out there movie. This one is not as weird as the David Lynch. It's much more linear and it's. Like people watch David Lynch and they're like, I don't even know what that movie was about. Like, if you don't know what this new Denis Villeneuve version of Dune is about, then you probably just fell asleep because it's pretty clearly laid out. You know, it's not a complex story. It's just about, you know, it just has some weird characters in it. But it's the story itself is pretty Disney. You know, it's the young story of a young prince coming of age, essentially.
Well, I guess the word of mouth on it's all been pretty positive.
It's beautiful. I'll probably watch it again, and I'll probably change my opinion about it.
Hasn't it already made enough to where they've locked in for a trilogy?
Well, the second one got approved. I know that much. I would assume, unless something really goes wrong with the second one, that we would get the full trilogy. That is the intention. And I think that's just a trilogy to tell the one book.
Wow.
So, I don't know. I mean, if it's all going to be like this, I think it's going to...
It's like a Lord of the Rings type scenario.
It's totally a Lord of the Rings. It's exactly 100% where I was going with this. And you know my feelings about Lord of the Rings. Like, I watched them all in the theaters. They were spectacles. They were grand. It was a great time in the theater. I watch them at home and I'm in and out. Like, oh, here's the part with the tree. Oh, no, this is the part where the trees are walking. No, okay, I'll be back later.
You got shit to do.
Yeah. No, I'm not enraptured by it. I still think they're great movies. And, you know, I might be enticed if they, like, did another run in the theater. And like, all right, yeah, I'll get high as fuck and waste, you know, a whole day in the theater watching dwarves and shit. But, yeah, I mean, it's kind of more the experience. So that's why I don't know. I'm probably going to, this weekend, I'm going to watch Dune because it's on the streamer as well. I have HBO Max. I could have watched it at home for free. But I was more interested in the cinematography more than anything else. I know the story of Dune. So I wanted to see it on a big screen, and I'm glad I did. You know, maybe I'll get more from it watching it on a small screen. But I have a feeling it's going to be like, well... That's even more boring on the smaller screen. I don't want to call the movie boring. I don't really think it's boring. I think it's clunky on the back end for sure. And if my eyelids were getting droopy, I cannot blame it on anyone who made the movie. I'm the one who consumed almost 100 milligrams worth of edibles going into it. So, you know, maybe... Maybe part of it was on me, and maybe I'll see it with new eyes when I watch it at home and can take a pee break. Telling you though, man, if these movies are going to continue to be this long, let's normalize intermissions. It's okay to interrupt the movie.
But they used to have them all the time. Remember? Yep. The dancing hot dog. Let's go out to the movies.
Let's go out to the movies.
All right.
It's the hot dog buns.
Yeah.
And the hot dogs dancing together.
And a box of popcorn.
And they're getting their freak on. Because, like, the hot dogs jump into the buns. I'm like, whoa, I got my kids here.
Yeah, right? Like, whoa, we're going right to anal?
Why would it have to be anal? The bun represents pussy.
True.
Can it?
But I mean, generally when you say the word buns, people think about your butt.
That's true. That's true. You're absolutely right. No, you're right. Hot dog in the bun, that's anal.
Yeah. It's like, hey, anal just to get snacks? That's a big ask of your date.
You got some hot dog in your bun? You got anal.
Hey, you want to go out to the movies with me? We'll have some anal. I don't know if I want to go on a date with you. That being said, follow us on social media, on Twitter, at TheWeisman420, at TheWeismanPodcast on Instagram, you know, the email, or at TheWeismanPodcast on Facebook as well, and email, it's TheWeismanPodcast at ChristopherMedia.net. which is where you go to hit the Amazon banner, hit the PayPal button. I can't even fucking talk. And then wherever you listen to us, rate us, review us, give us 5 stars. Please and thank you. Help tell people about the show. I mean, 4 is acceptable, 2. 3, we're getting dicey, but you know. We'd like to keep it, like, when I go to Amazon, I start with the 5-star reviews. When I'm looking for something to buy that I've never heard of, and that's kind of how podcasts work, too. So, you want to help people find us, rate us, review us, wherever you listen to us. Please and thank you. And stay high.
Stay high.
When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island, Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit royalcaribbean.com to learn more. When you're on a Royal Caribbean adventure, you're not just taking a vacation. You're taking it for all it's worth. Their ships are the largest in the world, and each one is packed with features you won't find anywhere else. There's world-class dining at restaurants like Izumi, the tallest slide at sea for thrill seekers, and Royal Caribbean's beautiful private island, Perfect Day at Coco Cay. A royal adventure is vacation time well maximized. Come seek the Royal Caribbean and rise to the vacation. Visit royalcaribbean.com to learn more.
The leading cause of death in America isn't what you would think. It's not heart disease, cancer, or COVID-19. Every day in America, 2,363 children die from this. It is the leading cause of death, and it is completely preventable. You can help put an end to the loss. Learn the truth at 2363.org. That's 2363.org. Paid for by Live Action.
The Weedsman Podcast. ChristopherMedia.net.